Hello students, today we shall discuss neoclassical painters and our objectives in learning this module will be to appreciate the artworks of the period, look at the lives and works of artists belonging to this period. The module is divided into the following: Introduction, Anton Raphael Mengs, 1728 to 1779. Jacques-Louis David, 1748 to 1825. Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, 1780 to 1867. William Hogarth, Angelica Kaufmann, 1741 to 1807. Francisco de Goya y Lucien, 1746 to 1828. Benjamin West. Winckelmann's closest friend and colleague in Rome was a fellow German by name of Mengs. His fresco Piranesis, painted in 1761 at the Villa Albani in Rome, created a sensation and helped establish the ascendancy of neoclassical painting. The scene is taken from classical mythology. Mount Parnassus in central Greece. Mount Parnassus in the central Greece was where the ancients believed Apollo, god of poetry, music and arts, and the nine muses, female personification of artistic inspiration, resided. Mengs depicted Apollo standing at the center, almost nude, holding a lyre and olive branch to represent artistic accomplishment. Jacques-Louis David, 1748 to 1825. The greatest painter of this style, his excellence lies in the fact in his natural gifts and scrupulous ability to render reality. His natural gifts, his paintings are influenced by the ideals of republican sentiments associated with classical antiquity. In the painting below, in the spirit of its times, you will see the values of honor and self-sacrifice taking precedence over life. You will see the three Horaeti taking the oath in front of their father. You will see the three Horaeti taking the oath in front of their father, who holds up their swords, one of the classic gestures of the neoclassical period. In contrasting attitude of the father and sons, the sisters and the child are in the series of fluid rhythmic curves, which reflect the view that they are more emotional. The figures wear Roman dress and the scene takes place in a Roman architectural setting before three round arches resting on a type of Doric column. The Death of Bharat is an extraordinary painting. While using the principles of neoclassicism, contemporary political events are shown. Bharat was stabbed in his bathtub by Charlotte Corday, a supporter of the conservative Girondin group. Both David and Bharat are Jacobins, a group of revolutionary extremists, and the patrons of Davy's painting. Davy himself was elected to the National Convention and voted to St. Louis XVI to the guillotine when Robespierre, the minister who presided over the reign of terror, fell. David was imprisoned twice, but he regained favor under the Napoleon, who appointed him to be his imperial painter. and granted him a barony. After Napoleon's exile, Davy left France and died in Brussels in 1825. Look at the dead Marat, slumped in his bathtub, his right hand still holding a quill pen, while his left hand grasps the letter that Gordy used to gain access to his home. Marat has affinities with Christian images of the dead Christ, emphasizing Marat's role as a political martyr. I hope that you can see Caravaggio's influence in the dark background, from which the figure emerges into light. Look at the pain associated with revolutionary political writing that stands opposite to the instrument of violence and death. After Napoleon was defeated in Italy in 1799, he asked his painter Davy to make a portrait of him crossing the Alps on a horse. He actually rode on a mule. Look at the very dynamic pose of Napoleon. It proclaims the past victories as permanent. It insists on its own reality. It dismisses the inconvenient present reality. While in reality he was short, David was painted him big enough for a horse, and here it seems that he will cross the Alps in just one jump. The three names on the stones on the bottom are three men who crossed the Alps, connecting Napoleon to history and victory. Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, 1780 to 1867. Ingres produced a large number of portraits and subject paintings using a variety of classical oriental themes, which are heavily dependent on linear design. A shallow picture plane and muted colors, his paintings embody the interplay of neoclassicism and romanticism with the hints of mannerist elegance. In the painting below, Napoleon is seated as a defied Roman Empire in his entire imperial splendor. Along with the exaggeration of mannerism, the clarity and precision of details are characteristics of neoclassical style. The formation of the large V looking upwards points to the grand stretcher, along with his scepter and the star pointing heavenward. Look at hollow like throne, echoing his laurel wreath. The red color also denotes his imperial power. His smooth finished surfaces were very characteristic of neoclassicism. William Hogarth, 1697 to 1764. William Hogarth will be remembered as the father of satirical caricatures and moral paintings, a genre which would later develop into cartoons. His determination and stout middle class values made him one of the most innovative artists of his generation, and he brought art to the common man for the first time in history. Rather than be influenced by many of the artists who had gone before him, Hogarth, a true innovator, tried to create a new school of English painting to revive the old masters of the Renaissance. Hogarth hoped to create a distinctively British style of art, free of obscure mythological references and encouraging the self-improvement in viewers that would lead to social progress. In fact, rather than influenced by their work, it has been suggested that he often ridiculed them. He attempts to build a reputation as a history painter, a portraitist, however, met with the financial disappointment, but his aesthetic theories had more influence in romantic literature than in painting. his themes were very neoclassical. Though his form and technique might not be. Hogarth portrays the sordid story and sad end of an arranged marriage between the children of an impoverished aristocrat and a social climbing member of newly wealthy merchant class. The cast of characters assembled to legalize the marriage. At the right of the painting sits Lord Scanderfield, raising his goatee, right foot on a footstool as he points to his lengthy family tree with a few wilted branches, which goes all the way back to the medieval knights, as if to say that the pile of money in front of him on the table is not payment enough for the marriage contract he is being asked to sign. Young Scanderfield at fop and a simpleton sits on the far left, admiring himself in the mirror and ignoring his future wife as he takes a pinch of snuff. His neck is already showing signs and syphilis. The unhappy bride-to-be is extravagantly dressed, but rather plain, and her wedding ring is threaded through a handkerchief to wipe away her tears. In the center, her father, the uncultured but wealthy merchant in the brass red coat, jeans forward to study Lord Scanderfield's pedigree and empties sack of money at his feet. The other men are lawyers, including the slippery silver tongue who is sharpening the quill that will seal the young couple's fate. Angelica Kaufmann. This Swiss history painter trained in Italy and arrived in London in 1766 to great acclaim, inspiring British artists to paint classical history paintings and British patrons to buy them. She was welcomed immediately into Jasio Reynolds' inner circle. Her paintings are outstanding examples of neoclassical style, accepted by the French Academy in the 19th century. Her favorite subjects were frolicking cherubs, chivalrous flirtations, and historical scenes, all within the guidelines firmly dictated by the Academy. Kaufmann recognized the danger of undue acceptance of strict rules, rejecting the overstated frigidity of the purest forms of neoclassicism and adding sensuous lines, a refined sensibility, and the harmonious feminine touch. She believed, as Winckelmann did, that unity and simplicity are the two sources of beauty. The scene in the painting took place in the 2nd century BCE. During the Republican era of Rome, a woman visitor shows Cornelio her jewels and then asks to see those of her hostess. In response, Cornelio shows her daughter and two sons, saying, "These are my most precious jewels." Cornelio exemplifies the good mother, a popular theme among some later 18th century patrons who preferred classical subjects that taught metaphorical lessons of civic virtue. The value of her maternal dedication is emphasized by the fact that her sons, Tiberius and Gaius Gregus, grew up to the political reformers. Kaufmann's composition is severe and classical, but she often softens the image with warm, subdued lighting, with the tranquil grace of her figures. the Goya by Lucians 1746 to 1828. One of the greatest Spanish artists, Goya lived through many changes, political, social, and his work defied easy categorization. Beginning as the court artist, he designed tapestries in a Spanish version of Rococo style. Prospering as a portraitist, he combined the neoclassical and Rococo elements. Under the French occupation of Spain, he painted portraits of both French and Spaniards. After the French defeat, he unleashed his paint of emotions in the powerful paintings and etchings. In his old age, he painted haunting and ferocious personal images that impressed the ideals of Romanticism. In the painting below, painted on linen and canvas, this was a tapestry design for the drawing room of Prince and Princess of Austria's. Prince and Princess of Austria's, the future King of Charles IV, and Maria Lucia de Parma in the Palace of the Prado, Madrid. Look at the fresh and warming coloring and the damsel responding to a gallant flirtation, and the lit background make this one of Goya's most careful paintings and his own take on French Rococo, as much as it is about mix of Spanish and French fashion. In his images of war, Goya champions Enlightenment views of individual freedom against political oppression, where Napoleon installed his brother on the throne of Spain in 1808. An open revolt spread all over Spain against France. However, Goya did not paint this till 1814, till all was quieter. Look at the cathedral in the distant city at night time. How he dramatically juxtaposes the visible faces of the victims with the covered faces of the diagonal executioners. With the covered faces of the diagonal executioners, the French. This painting is an image of blind terror and a desperate fear. There is no moral here, only hopeless rage. The emotional poses and gestures, accentuated by thick brushstrokes, and the stress on the individual reactions to the blind brute forces of the firing squad, are characteristic of Goya's romanticism. His painting has now moved from the relative restraint of the court to impatient romanticism. Also look at the heroic figure in the center in yellow and white, standing with hands raised in a Christ-like position. Although etching was not new to the 19th century, its use in combination with aquatint was. In aquatint, the artist covers the spaces between etched lines with a layer of rosin, a form of powdered resin. This partially protects against the effects of the acid bath. Since the rosin is porous, the acid can penetrate to the metal. But the artist controls the acid's effect on the plate by treating the plate with varnish. This technique expands the range of grainy tones in the finished prints. Aquatint thus combines the principles of engraving with the effects of watercolor or wash drawings. Goya invented this style of etching. In 1799, Goya published Los Caprichos, a series of etchings combined with the new medium of aquatint, and depicts psychological phenomena, often juxtaposing them with an educational or social message. In this painting, you will see the slumbering personification of reason is haunted by a menagerie of demonic looking owls, bats and a cat that are let loose when reason sleeps. This set of etching plates were completed in about 1815, but were published in 1863 only due to the aggressive government. Here, the officer contemplates his hanging victim with satisfaction. You can see the other hanged man in the room. Look at the triangular formations of this hanged man and the smaller one of the officer's postures separately. His newbing titles for each etching only exaggerate the effect they have on the viewer eyesight. And this too, all this and more, the same thing elsewhere, ETL. We are compelled to think about how both the today and that remote past are the same in terms of violence committed. Let us look at some more of his works. Benjamin West, 1738 to 1820. West studied in Philadelphia before he left for Rome in 1759, where he met Winckelmann and became a student of Manx. In 1763, he moved permanently to London, where he specialized in neoclassical history painting. In 1768, along with Kaufmann and Reynolds, he became a founding member of the Royal Academy. He painted historical scenes primarily. Look at this one, for instance. One of the biggest departures here is in the costumes. Characters are shown in the contemporary costumes. His intention was to keep grandness of the masses and the themes intact rather than the portrayal. This painting, no wonder, is called the first modern painting. West's painting glorifies the British general James Wolfe, who died in 1759 in the British victory over the French for the control of Quebec during the Seven Years' War. During the Seven Years' War, 1756 to 1763, look at his red uniform, the cloud-swept sky, portrayed in a very naturalistic manner, while maintaining the heightened emotional intensity of valor and heroism.